All right, we're live again. Sorry for the delay. So, hi, my name is Sebastian, and I want to talk about putting hypermedia back in rest with JAX-RS. So, I'm a freelancer based in Munich, and I've done a lot with rest, or what is considered to be rest in the real world and real world projects. And yeah, and I want to show you a few examples, want to show you what hypermedia is about and how that could be implemented using Java EE technology. So REST APIs in real-world projects, how do they look like? Maybe do they look like something like this? You have a resource to do some action, some cool verb. It somehow feels like a remote procedure call. You have input parameters and you have output parameters. I mean, that's an easy way to somehow remotely call a function. But of course, that shouldn't be the way to go. I mean, if you look at this example, you might get the feeling that it's something like soap without a soap envelope, and yeah, that's it. So it's not really, shouldn't be the way to go. It's actually like RPC HTTP style API and not what should be considered as a resource or as REST. And you see a post, so because it's always a post to some URL. And even the same example, if you would get some information from a URL. So you might have seen that in real-world projects as well. So you have really a verb, do something, and you post to this with some input parameters, and you get some resource back. But yeah, that's where resources come in. Because actually, your URLs, in terms of REST, shouldn't be like do some action or do something, a verb, rather than that they should reflect your business entities, your real objects. Because in your application, it depends on what you're talking about. You're normally talking about users, a university has students, cars, objects, articles, books, whatever. But you're not talking about actions. And this means your URLs should reflect something like your business entities. Because they are, in fact, and that's the definition, a representation of your business entities, a representation of some resource. So something like this. You have a GET request for GET users, which means you want probably a list of all users, and you get a response back. Actually, it doesn't matter here if whether that's XML or JSON, it's just an example. And you get a user named Duke, has an ID, and so on and so forth, and maybe five other users, who knows. And yeah, this is actually much better in a sense of RESTful URLs. You now have a real object represented by the URL in terms of here a list of users. Yeah, we will later talk about hypermedia. The thing here is what I often hear, the common misconceptions, that REST is something about predictable URLs, what I partly agree. Because you might think, you might have the implicit logic here that you say you have the user's response and you actually want to get this user here. So what you do, you take users slash 123345, right? Because that's, yeah, that's the assumption that this should be the URL of that Duke, of that user specifically. Yeah, but what's shown here and what's already much better, the use of semantic HTTP. Because you have some things like HTTP methods, like get, put, post, delete, path, and so on, and HTTP status codes. And in fact, they should be used the way they are defined. So if you look at the HTTP RFC, they all have some kind of meaning and yeah, some kind of semantic what they are meant to be used. Like this example. You want to create a new user. So you're posting to the user's response, to the list of users actually, a new user named Duke. And what you get back here, so actually you don't say something like create user, rather than you go to the user's response to you, that business object of the users. And you get the response 201 created, because you might be surprised, but there's more than 200 okay. There are several status codes and they all have different semantics. 201 created in this case means you have a new resource, you just created a new resource, which in fact you have. and it tells you the location of that resource created. This is much better than just returning 123.45 and let the client assume that the URL will be /123.45. And exactly that point is where hypermedia kicks in, because you want to direct the user to the different resources, and that's what hypermedia is about. You're accessing one resource and you're providing some links to the client to somehow relate it resource to the one you just got. Which means, if you think of a website, for example, it's a website which you visit as a human. You go to the website of the Hannover University and you want to have some, let's say, contact information, for example. So what do? You look at the response, you probably look at the HTML, then you see some link to a contact page, you take the ID of the link, go to your address bar and type in the domain slash that ID. No, you don't do that. You click on the link because it was supposed to be to follow the user to a related resource, in that case a contact page. And this is pretty much the same for hypermedia APIs. Not in a sense that you do somewhat like artificial intelligence, rather than you provide some method and some functionality, some logic, how to follow the links. For example here, we have the users again, and you have a list of users. We have the JUG again here. And rather than sending the ID and let the client assume how the ID of that user JUG would be, you send a link with a relation self. And the client now only has to know that the relation self somewhat has to do with the JUG, with the user, actually. And it only needs to know that self relation here, and will know that that URL here, we pointed to the user, which is in fact, which contains that link. So there might be five users and all of them have the self link, but that one is the link for the user. And therefore you direct your client to use that resource here. This is another example. This time here is in JSON, but actually it doesn't matter. We have a book here, something like Amazon, probably. You have a book, a name, and has an author, it may have an ISBN availability, like in stock or sold out, a price, something else. And you have a set of links here defined. The self link is somewhat like we saw already. It's just a link to the same resource. And you have an add to cart link. This is really like if you're on that website again, if you're on Amazon, you have a fancy link, add to shopping cart. And this is pretty much the same here, because what does it give you here? First of all, the client then doesn't have to know what the link to the add to cart functionality or the shopping cart is, because you just include it in your response. And therefore, the server gets back the control of your URLs in this case. And what's more, probably you want to add some logic. If you say, okay, client, please include a fancy add to cart button, but only include that button if the article is in stock or the user has a certain credit in his account or the user is over 18 years old, I don't know, whatever your business logic may be. And the point is, you don't want to have the business logic twice in your client, that you say, okay, client, if availability is in stock and so on and so forth, then display the button, rather than you say, okay, I only need to know that relation, add to cart, I know what that is, and I tell the client, okay, whether you find a link with that relation, please include a fancy button and use the URL to access the functionality. And therefore, you get several things back, so the server is in control of the URLs again and of the business logic again, because the business logic should solely reside on the server side and not on the client side. You don't want to have it twice. Thanks. Okay, what's more? You may ask the question, it's an easy way probably on a website if you have a link with a lot of parameters and you're adding something to a shopping cart, right? But in this case, you only have the URL, shopping cart. You actually don't know how to use it, because a get shopping cart probably won't get you far. Probably won't enable the server to add that book to your shopping cart. And this is pretty much the thing where you have to decide for your application how much general applicable logic you want to include in your media type, actually, in your API, which means how general usable should the client be, or how many how much of the implicit logic you want to add. Because in this case, the client still would have to know that it should post something to that URL, and it probably posts some ID and the quantities and the number of books you want to have, or actually the whole request the client then should send to add the book to a cart has to be known to the client. Make sense? Any questions so far? By the way, if you have a question at any time, feel free to ask. You get cool stuff for this. All right? Okay, so here it's a more fully fledged example of the same thing I just showed. The three dots above, just imagine this is the same response. This is also a book, and it may have a name, an author, an ISBN, I don't know, and may some links. And this one is new, some actions. So this is a different media type. Actually, it's a more or less standardized media type. It's called Siren. There are several of them. I will show them in a minute. And this gives you even the functionality to let the client know how to add the things to the shopping cart. Because you now have the name adds to cart. This is something like a relation. And it even tells you the method, the URL, of course, just like before, the type, so the content type, which has to be sent for this, and even the fields. And the cool thing here is, now the client only has to know what that field ID is about, so it has to know where that comes from, where that information comes from, and the quantity. That ID may, in fact, come from the resource itself, so the book may include some ID, just for the identification on the server side. And a quantity, so how many books you want to add to your cart, it may be a drop-down or just whatever your client looks like. And then the client can fully automatically send that to the server. It doesn't need to have some implicit logic programmed here. And this is really then the cool thing in terms of that you really are flexible, that the server is flexible in what can be changed, in fact. So it could change a lot of things here without breaking the client. And this is really the benefit you get from this. All right. There are several hypermedia formats. This a lot even more. You can invent your own. It actually doesn't matter. The thing is, all of these are JSON. So you can go just with application JSON or application JSON something, your company name or whatever, or invent your own. These are just like tries to standardize some ways. They give you a certain set of control and power. The first hell, for example, doesn't allow something like actions. The example I just showed you, so to introduce these fields and how to define them. Some of them are more powerful, some of them are less. I showed you Siren, this is quite powerful, and I think it could be quite usable for real-world projects. Another one is JSON Schema. This is even more powerful because it gives you, it enables the client to not only let it know how to use a URL, rather than it also tells it how your business objects look like. Which means if you have a user and you that user has a name and an ID, it tells you, okay, a name, what is that exactly? And it has a schema included in that API already, so you can really go to some kind of definition, some kind of like documentation automatically included there and see what a name is in this case. So it's like a string, it has to be this and that, way, size, something. Whatever your business logic may look like. And this is actually the point of hypermedia, how generally applicable your API is. For example, let's go back to the very first thing. If you only use resources like get users and post probably, and with the IDs and the implicit logic how to combine the URLs, what you would have to do in your real-world application, you would have to document everything, right? Because some user who uses your API has no clue how that thing might work. So that post to users has to document the user, okay, what should I in fact post here? It can be a name, it can be some ID, some author, ISBN, whatever. And that has to be documented in this case. And the more generally applicable your API is, the less you have to document, because your API should be self-explanatory. English. Yeah. And this helps you a lot, because the server is then in control of the certain things, like the example with the website again. So JSON schema, in fact, is even more powerful. It would even give you the documentation for free, because then the documentation would be fully included in your API. You wouldn't have to document something. You only would need to implement something. And that's the keyword. Let's implement something. So I would just start with the example we had before, something like this, but only in JSON, because JSON is cool. And we will do something a JE application, media test or something. This is just a small Maven application. It's a Maven archetype which creates a Maven Java E7 project. Really simple. I'll show you. I'll open that with IntelliJ. Hello. There's all these buttons here. Let's open up that again. Any questions so far? No questions? You don't want to ask anything? Okay, that's fine. Sorry? Yeah, we have some other stuff. You can have some other stuff too, not only stickers. All right. Let's open up this. This is, as I said, just a simple Maven Java 7 project, which already includes a JAX-RS activator, that's just a JAX-RS application subclass, nothing special here, and basically it's empty. All right. So let's add some resource, some JAX-RS resource. All right. Yeah, that projector somehow sucks. I will increase the font size in it. Better? Yeah. Okay. I hope the video stream can. Stephen said it's a good low light resolution. All right. Books resource, because we want to talk about books, right? This is just will be a JAX-RS resource. So we start with an EJB and a path. This is really simple. It would tell you books. And yeah, we will have a resource books. Sorry? You think so? OK. Font.
Can you guys see in the back?
Better?
Bigger.
All right. I don't know how to. Increase this actually. Should be right. Otherwise, we don't have space to program anything. All right. We will. This will use plain Java E7. We will include a list of books here. This is the resource which will give you a list of books. It's really nothing special. Oops. We don't want this here. We want our own class. We will use POJOs in this example. These are just POJOs with some annotations to control the output. So let's say we have something like an ID in our book. We have something like a name. Oops. Something like an author. And yeah, probably a price.
Mode
Ach so. Presentation mode does not work for this example here. Is there some kind of... Anyway. By the way, don't do money calculations for real-world projects in floating point numbers, right? This is just an example. All right. All right, getters and setters, and just for convenient use, add some constructors. Add a default constructor. All right. So nothing special. That book. We will have a list of books here. And as this is a Java E project, we will include some EJB, and the books will come from that EJB. Let's call that bookstore. We will say, OK, return bookstore get books. And yeah, but we will only need a few classes. It's OK in this case. All right. This bookstore is also EJB, right? A stateless. And it will just have a method list of books and create some books for you. So return list of new books with an ID. It has a name, Java, from the author, Duke. And what do we have? A price. And another book with another ID, Hello World. Oh yeah, will be cool. Awesome. Table is pretty small. All right.
Be careful with the
yep. All right. Nothing special. And this will return the list of books. Questions so far? Good. And of course, you want to have a separate books included, a separate book resource for a single book, which means get a book for a separate ID. And this is the point. Don't tell the client about this logic. It shouldn't know this implicit logic that it's books slash the ID. It could be books slash anything. Long ID, and return bookstore get book from the ID. And it will tell you return a new book with the ID Java Duke 2999. This is really simple. I won't even run this because it won't give you anything about links. And now we include that. You saw in the example, we will add something like here, something like a link resource, or actually something like there, because we have JSON here, with that self URI in this case. Which means we need some links here. So we have a map of strings to URIs. The string will be the relation in this case. Yep. And you can also, and this is a funny thing, add JAX-B annotations on this, even if you output JSON. Because the JSON implementations will take care of this, and if you say, okay, I want to have a different name here, probably with underscore links, this will be taken into account. And the ID should not be presented here, because our resource will, in fact, produce application JSON. Application, yep, this one, JSON. And now we can add some links here. If we add the getters and setters, And then, and this is the cool thing, we can add the links to our list of books in this case. So each book has a self link, obviously a URL where it can be accessed, and we want to include this for every book in that list, in fact. This means we're using, just because it's cool, we're using the Java 8 Stream API. For this, we have a book here, and that book should now get a link as well, which means get link that map. You will put a self link here, and this is one of the examples where hypermedia helps you a lot, because where JAX-RS helps you a lot, the JAX-RS implementation, because how to create the URLs, because you want to have the books /12345 or /something, and they might be even longer, and you don't want to repeat yourself over and over again within your whole application, because that may come at a lot of places if you build a big API, because the URIs may, yeah, in fact, appear in a lot of places. There is a functionality called URI Builder. It can be injected with context. This can inject several context objects from JAX-RS. It's included in JAX-RS. And it's called URI Info. And the cool thing about this, it gives you some builder pattern-like functionality to create the URIs programmatically. So you say, I have a self URI that comes from the URI Info. Say base URI builder, what that is, I will explain in a minute. And you can actually access something reflection like your JAX-RS implementation classes and your JAX-RS methods to get access to these paths you define here. And you don't have to repeat yourself over and over again. So you can say books resource book class will give you the books string here, and path books resource dot class get book, this one down there, will give you that ID. But hang on, I don't want to have curly bracket ID, I want to have the actually ID, right? And this is why the build method can can have some values added, which then gets taken into account for the separate for the URL creation. So that gets substituted here, which means you have the book get ID, and this will in fact substitute that path parameter, and then you have the URI created from that JAX-RS functionality. This gets added to the map down here, and then you're basically done. What did we do here? Any questions so far? Should be clear in this case. We called the EJB. We get the list of books. We applied a mapping functionality to create the URI for each book, pointing to the book URI location, and adding it to the links of that book. And pretty much the same will be done here. We don't have a string, sorry. This is only one book. We say book and book get links. And this is then pretty much the same as here. Copy paste programming, book. And we have a book here. The same story we had above. In your reward applications, you certainly want to outsource this into either another CDI managed class or some helper functionality or some private method, surely. And another URI in this case. Because as the example here just showed, on that books resource, we want to have the self URI and that adds to cart functionality. And maybe that add to cart functionality should only be included if your business logic matches. Which means add to cart URI here gets created in a similar way. I will I will copy that at first as it was here, but now it will of course point to another resource, cart resource class. We don't have that resource right now, but that doesn't matter because we can just create it. I won't increase the font size here, just for the sake of the example. This will only be an empty JAX-RS resource having the URI shopping cart. And that's it. I will immediately close it. It will work. And of course, we don't need any parameter to be substituted here. It will just include that shopping cart URI. And that's it. And this will be also added to the links of that specific book accessed here in that JAX-RS resource. Any questions? Everything crystal clear? All right. I will try to run that example. This is a default Maven build. We would just hit Maven clean install. And as Java E7 is crazy fast, even faster than I can talk, this will be done. And we'll deploy it on a wildfly. This takes a WAR file, which just got built, and deploy it. And yep, no error so far. And then you want to fire up a REST client of your choice. I'll take Postman in that example. And like in a cooking show, of course, I've prepared something. And that's it. We have a list of books in this case, including that link. And I can just click on this and access that one. And it will also add the add to cart link here, this link. Questions? Should be fine, right? About the URI info here. One of the cool things here, the URI info takes into account how your current request looks like, which means if you probably don't access your server directly, rather than you have some kind of Apache proxy or some Nginx proxy in your real-world projects, right? You can in fact change that domain here. I've set it up a local domain pointing to the loopback, and magic, it will appear here because it takes the current request, and depending on how the request looks like, it may send a different server in that HTTP, it may send a different port, which later then gets transferred by your proxy. Nevertheless, it sends the original one back because this thing is the URI the client obviously wants to access. And that was what get base URI builder was about, because it takes a base URI, it takes a builder of your base URI, and the base URI of the current request is just the server the client sent. All right, questions? Good. So let's take a more complicated example, actually a different one, because this one here uses POJOs, which is in fact quite practical, but you may have several situations and you may get pretty quickly to the point where you say these POJOs aren't flexible enough what I want to do. For example, if you have the books resource, you may not want to include all of the information of every book in that list of books, but probably in that book resource of the book itself, maybe. And you may have some more complexity, and you may need some more power to more control here. And this is why that can be changed to something else. To in fact use not POJOs here, rather than something what is called JSONP API, which is included in Java E7, which enables you to programmatically create JSON objects. And then it doesn't matter what your API should look like, because you can do whatever you like using some builder pattern style similar to this we did here, which means you have something like JSON array for the list of books in this case. And now you have to do something different, because you have your book, and then that should be in fact a JSON object, which means you say, okay, for this book, please create JSON create object builder, builder pattern like add probably a name that comes from get name, probably add author, if I could spell, and so on and so forth. And please also add links. And the link itself is another JSON object. Let's call it nested links, because I could also create an object builder down there, but then we will lose the control. It gets too complex. And this, in fact, can then be returned from that mapping functionality, and then be created into a JSON array. And just because we can, we'll use fancy method handles here. JSON create array builder, JSON array builder colon add, JSON array builder double colon add. And this is pretty much it. We have a JSON create object builder. And this one creates a JSON array builder, and this one creates a JSON array. And then we would have to to create another JSON object, the nested links, JSON create object builder. This will be the links, JSON object in this case. So add self relation from that self URI. The JSONP API, unless the POJOS does not allow a URI to be included in a JSON, it has to be some kind of primitive or a string. So this is why we just call URI.toString and create an object out of this. This object gets added here, gets built up into a whole JSON object here, and then we have that collect method collecting it to a JSON array. Questions? Everything clear? Just ask. You're not sure?
More of a general question.
Yeah.
Aspects of security, with all the links and things like that, is a consideration you have to take?
In terms of what? That you can... Oh, sorry. Yeah. The question was in terms of security, if security is something you have to take into account by the URI creation. And yeah, the question would be, security in terms of what? How you identify your user, or
I'm just wondering if it's a consideration at all in the design for this kind of API. If you have got a lot of user context, business logic, if you like, in your backend system, how would you handle that safely in a secure way, as well as maybe the information you're passing backwards and forwards?
Yeah. Okay, I get that. The thing is, the business logic should only reside on the server side. So this is, I would say, safe in this case, that you don't output any information, any user-related information. And of course, something like a card should be the shopping cart should be identified by some functionality, probably a session cookie. Which means if you use that API, you would I have to identify the user which currently interacts with your API somehow. Maybe with a session cookie, with something like OAuth, and so on and so forth. And then, of course, that URI you're presenting, or that functionality you have, only corresponds to that user.
And just relying on HTTPS for encryption or things like that?
Probably. But this is really the same like for other HTTP APIs. This is nothing hypermedia specific in this case, security. Thanks.
No specific requirements then?
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? You weren't that sure? Okay.
I was wondering which time you're already making this presentation? Because
Sorry?
you're tipping pretty fast. Which time are you making this already?
Which
how many times have you done this?
Not that much. not that many times. I could create something else. It's not like I did it prepared too much. You can tell me just what I some any other business object. No. Yeah, but everything here is crystal clear with the Lambda kind of things and the metal method handles and the JSONP because it's pretty new for the Java E7. Oh, he gets a present, of course. Ask questions, you get presents. The live audience, unfortunately, can't ask questions. Or at least they you can, but you won't get presents.
They have a bunch more events to come to if they want to. Yeah, no questions yet.
All right, I will carry on. And of course, this resource here also creates something JSONP-like. In this case, it's a JSON object. You have a book here, and that to your eyes. And you again have that JSON create object builder functionality. It's pretty much the same, so we will again copy-paste program. Don't do this in production. And add something like, okay, this is a book. This is also a book, and we have links here. Oh, actually, I can copy that too. And this will create a JSON object out of the self link, and in this case also with add to cart. And that add to cart URI. And yeah, to string in this case. And as I said, you may add some business logic saying if something here, then only then create that add to cart URI and so on and so forth. Totally depends on what you want to achieve. And this gives you pretty much the same output as it was before, hopefully. So let's rebuild that again using a Maven clean install build and redeploy it on Wildfly again. And if you look in our REST client, then the output should be pretty much the same, that you say, okay, you have a list of books here. That's the other server, but it doesn't matter. And you have, let's take that one, two resources here. And then again, you have the self resource and the shopping cart resource. And this enables you to do things like that pretty easily, because then this is also JSON. It enables you to fully control what your output may look like. And if you say you take some more or less standardized media type format, or maybe invent your own, you can do whatever you like using the JSONP API to create crazy complex JSON resources. Yeah, this is a different JSONP, and I hate them for choosing that name. What your JSONP is called JSON padding. And what I'm talking about is JSONP, it's JSR 353. This is a JSR, a Java E standardization, just to programmatically, API for JSON processing, and that's where the P comes from. And unfortunately, it's the same P like JSON padding, but it has nothing to do with this. So this is not like the JavaScript front-end frameworks often use JSONP, so this padding, JSONP, you're right. But this JSONP is a Java E standardization. Good question. See if he gets a present. All right. Of course, for some hypermedia type content types, there are already pre-built frameworks. For example, for that Siren. I won't, because of the time, I won't show you these examples right here, but actually I have something more or less prepared in this case on my GitHub account. You can see some examples. On here for Siren, it's pretty much the same what's in the presentation, that's or similar in this case. It's also about books. This is a more complex Hello World example of a hypermedia API using different approaches. Before, it was something like simple resource links. So you might.
And the GitHub address is?
Sorry, I will say that in a minute. Carry on. And we will have some Siren example here as well. And this one shows you how that could be created using some third-party dependency, because there is, can you read this? Come on, zoom. There is already something built called Siren4j. And what does it do? Similar to that JSONP approach, it gives you a programmatically functionality to create what is, for Siren is called entities. So actually to programmatically create that entities, not with that complexity like JSONP has, so that you can control anything, rather than the Siren has obviously a specific format with these actions and links and so on and so forth, and they give you some functionality like add action, add link. We can have a look at some example. I think they're called link builder or something. No, I think I have to choose for a search for that entity. I think entity builder. Add property, add link, add what do we have, add action. So it's pretty much the same. Also that builder pattern like style, but of course with predefined methods just for your Siren. You can of course use something like this if you use something like Siren, but if you don't want to have that third-party dependency, and this is why I showed you the JSONP approach, you may go with that, because that is really plain Java E7 and you don't get anything else in your WAR file, and your WAR file keeps the same, and this is why you can build the whole thing and see it in two seconds with your whole JSONP approach. Yeah, and it also gives you, I don't even want to talk about this, gives you some functionality like the JAX-B approach was, to control the output via annotations. So that you say, okay, this is a Siren something entity, and you can control the links and the actions using annotations. But I claim this doesn't give you enough flexibility, because for several situations, like the add to cart, you may control programmatically from your business logic whether some actions or links will be available or not, or whether they will be the same or change. And this is why I would say the programmatic approach is a pretty good one for such APIs, because you certainly need the flexibility. And I've seen this a lot, that you need this flexibility pretty fast, actually. Any questions so far? Just because you asked, this is on GitHub. I can include the URI. Actually, will be on the video. It's my GitHub account is sdashner, and this is JAX-RS Hypermedia in this case. And it may come even more. There's a few examples how an JAX-RS, how a Hypermedia API implemented with JAX-RS could look like. All right. Yep. Sure.
You always send a REST request via Postman?
Yeah.
Is there a possibility to send such a request via Linux command line?
Totally. If I'm not that familiar, but we can. Oh, sorry. The question was, I'm using Postman in this case. Is there any other functionality, maybe for a Linux command line to do this? And of course it is. curl HTTP localhost. Now you really got me. I'm using this rarely, but I may. what's that? Hypermedia test. Resources, books. You see, it works. This is the output for JSON, and then for the post, of course, you can do something else like curl minus x post or something. Yeah, it totally works. Anything which understands HTTP can be used to access this. I'm just using Postman because it's convenient, but you can use whatever you like for a REST client. Actually, there are some approaches how a Siren, in this case, browser could look like, so that it gives you a bit more functionality, like the Postman also does, that you can click on some links and so on and so forth, that because it automatically understands some kind of that content type you have. Any other questions? Yep. No?
Regarding these hypermedia formats, yep. Which is the most widespread or often used one, and do you think it's a good choice of the majority?
I wouldn't say if there is a really widespread one, hell probably is. But I wouldn't, well, whether that's a good choice, it always depends, I would say. Hell does not allow you, or the default one, to add some actions like we had for Siren. And this is why I think Siren is more or less a pretty good choice. This is why I included it in my examples. Something like JSON schema even gives you more flexibility, as I said. But it totally depends on your use case. And the thing you might want to note is that it always depends on what you try to do and how much general applicable logic you may want to have. Because, of course, it's nice if a client stays almost free of business logic, but you sooner or later have to implement the logic how you follow these siren actions, actually. Because you build something like, not a web browser, but something similar, which can understand what the response is about. And I would say the bigger your API is and the more it is used by a huge different clients or different users, the easier it pays off for the long run to use hypermedia in this case. And okay. I would say you can, of course, do something like I showed at the very beginning, something like a simple REST example. It has a very, I would say, short-term productivity. It's really productive for the first one if you have some JavaScript client or any other client which consumes that, and you say, okay, I just tell them how the URIs will be constructed. That's a pretty easy way to go, but it pays off for the long run if you implement something like a hypermedia API.
So, but if I understand you correctly, none of this is really in widespread use?
Not yet, unfortunately. Okay. So, as I said, also for my projects, we used something like the simple resource link approach, that you at least provide the links to all URLs, and the client should not implicitly create them. And then you can also control some sort of things like that add to cart, but still the client has to know certain things. And this is the highest, let's call it that way, hypermedia approach I found in real-world projects so far. But yeah, as you're talking about widespread use, yeah. The links get used more and more, but yeah, let's spread the word and use hypermedia when it's appropriate.
If another question, yeah? Is okay.
Sure.
How about client-side libraries? Is there a Siren? Mm-hmm. JavaScript library, or
I don't know, but JavaScript, but for Java, yes, it has, and you might use something like this, but only up to a certain amount, surely, because sooner or later, like we had that quantity and the IDs, how to add the books, has to be the independent client logic, sure, because it has to be the mapping somehow. But surely you want to reuse that general applicable logic, how to access and how to follow the URIs in your client. Yeah.
Thanks.
Any other questions? Well then, thanks a lot for your attention.
Okay, so we have a second presentation. We're gonna talk about this guy. Who likes video games? Okay, so I'm gonna put on, let's say, Super Mario Brothers.
Steven, this way. Hold him to the camera. Yeah.
Let me switch the screen for a sec. Okay, and we're gonna put on Super Mario Brothers and see how it works. So this is a 3D printed case. I did the 3D modeling for the design for the case. It has a Raspberry Pi inside of it. And the software running on it is an entirely Java-based emulator called HalfNES. So it's all Java. It all works, and you can actually play Mario. Okay, who wants to try playing it? Who likes video game? Okay. And after you're done, pass it around. All right, and I'm going to show you guys how you can make your very own Raspberry Pi device like that. And actually, I also figured out the secret to getting this setup to work. So I need this cable. Can you plug this into the HDMI in my computer? On the side?
Yeah.
Other side.
Yeah.
And I think that goes into the Perl. Okay, now this is going to be super funky for a little bit. Because we're going to have a picture and a picture and a picture and a picture. Oh, I can't even tell which one it is. That one. Okay, so I'm using the same laptop to present, and now it's going to get a picture and a picture and a picture and a picture and a picture. But that means it's working. And now we can pop open PowerPoint. Hopefully, let me check the broadcast console. Yeah, it actually is working. And let me borrow your mic instead.
Yeah, sure.
Use this as the audience mic. Okay, so I'm the community chair for Java 1. I'm also the Java community manager. And I manage all of this stuff here, you know, a few user groups. Any of you guys members of a user group? Everyone should be raising their hand. It's a JUG meeting. Anybody contributed?
Some cool open source project, probably.
Anyone contributed to the JCP? Oh, very good. We have two JCP contributors. The JCP is a great community process for writing stuff like JAX-RS is a spec.
For example, yeah.
For example, JSF is a spec. Do you mind also doing camera for me?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, okay, there we go. All right, so we're back on audio as well. And we are going to attempt to build an NES emulator. So the NES was actually one of the more successful consoles in the world. Maybe I should stand on the side so you're not pointing at that. And I think we can bring the lights back on in the front because I don't have any live coding. Flip the lights for a sec. So some of the unique attributes of the NES is it at the time it kind of revived the video game market. This was back in the 80s after the crash of Atari. And it was really hard for any companies to get like widespread adoption of video game platforms, but the Super Famicom is the Japanese name for the Nintendo. That got really popular, and they imported to the U.S. under the name NES. So if you lived in the U.S., you would have gotten one of these gray ones. In the Europe, was it gray or red, the NESs?
Gray.
Okay, so the Europe got the same U.S.-style ones. In Japan, they're like a red beige-ish color. It's kind of weird. And Super Famicom stands for Family Computer. Anyway, there's 826 different ROMs, and it doesn't sound like a lot, but actually the ROMs are all like weird custom hybrid things where they do all sorts of tricks between the different chips. There's a graphics processing, a pixel processing unit, a audio processing unit, and a CPU. And they would play tricks with the timings between the different chips to write to different registers at different points, like in the middle of scan lines and all sorts of funky stuff. And that's how they would do crazy stuff like split screen and all sorts of these things which are not supported in the base hardware. The Motorola chip itself has 3,510 transistors. It was a derivative chip with, I think it had less floating point unit stuff because they didn't need it, and therefore it was cheaper to manufacture, and 92 million synchronization points. So what this means is it's a really hard problem to emulate games, and it's actually the hardest part is playing the games, right? Because you have to play lots of games to test your emulator. So anyone know this game? Ninja Gaiden? This is top five hardest games on the NES console. It was physically impossible to beat you. I think I left my console on for 2 weeks to finally beat the game. It was that hard. How about Mega Man? Yeah, okay. Some people played this. Now which Mega Man did you play? Game Boy, Mega Man Game Boy version. But you ever play the original Mega Man, Mega Man 1?
Yeah, I was
talking about SNES. Okay, SNES. Yeah, those are easy. So the problem, it looks cute. The problem with Mega Man 1 is the controls were horrible. Like jumping and shooting this little guy here, you just can't do. Like there's all these funky things with the controls and the speed and the stopping and the enemy design that made it just impossible to win. Horribly imbalanced. And how about this? Anyone play shooters? This is actually an SNES shooter. But these are basically, it's a game of trying to avoid thousands of flying shots all coming at once. So after a while, you reach Nirvana, which is, who knows what this is? Yeah, okay, so that's close. What company makes Street Fighter? Yeah, that's true. So this isn't a Street Fighter game. Anyways, it's the Konami code. All the Konami games, like Contra, Gradius, like all those, you put them through this code and you get infinite lives and all sorts of cool stuff. So all right, so getting to this is the actual one you're passing around. The first version was red. That one has since been disassembled and put back in a new case. And that's my daughter playing it. And we're going to talk about the electronics inside of it first. So inside of it is a Raspberry Pi. It's actually a Raspberry Pi 2. Anyone know what the latest Raspberry Pi model is? 3. Very good. Okay, so I heard you in the front first. So here, have something. Yeah, so the Raspberry Pi 3 just came out. It's really cool. If you happen to order one earlier in the week, you might have a chance of getting one. If not, you're out of luck because they're already sold out. the Raspberry Pi 2 is really good as well. It's fast. It's got a quad-core chip, 1 gigahertz, a gig of RAM, four USB ports, Ethernet port, SD card, micro SD card on this model, not full-size SD on the older ones. Micro USB for power, so you can power it off like a laptop or a cell phone charger. GPIO headers, and GPIO headers are kind of what one of the most interesting things that you can do with the console, because that lets you attach different electronic devices on top of it. So does anyone know what these two are on top for? Who said that? Ah, okay. What would you like? Throw something at him. Maybe a USB key. Yeah, that button's fine, yeah. Okay, what about the second one? Anyone know? Display. Someone says display? Maybe. Okay, anyway, the second one is a display. So you can hook up display and camera. Now, in both cases, it's kind of like semi-proprietary because these access the Broadcom GPU directly to do the work. So the Raspberry Pi Foundation put out a camera module and they put out a display module. The display module's great if you want a clunky 7-inch display that's like a brick. Not so great if you want to build a handheld console. So if you want to attach a display to the Raspberry Pi, what are your options for doing so? And there's basically 4 different ways you can do it. So the Raspberry Pis all have a composite port except for the Raspberry Pi Zero and the Raspberry Pi A. No, those have it too. Yeah, the Raspberry Pi Zero is the only one which doesn't have a composite port. So composite's okay, but it's like low quality. It's like your old analog tubes. And it doesn't look that great when you back convert it to an LCD panel, and it sucks up a fair amount of power usage because you have to do the conversion. You have to have a chip to do the back conversion. HDMI is better quality, and this is what I would recommend if you have a Raspberry Pi for most everything. But also, it requires either an HDMI display, or if you use an LCD display, you need an extra
board, which is going to convert from HDMI to a standard LCD signal. SPI is a nice hack. There's actually a bunch of LCD screens which support SPI kind of natively. This is a special serial interface that's high performance, but it's not high enough performance if you're trying to do graphics. So you get about 10 to 15 frames per second. Which, anyone know offhand how many frames per second the old NES consoles were? Maybe. So think about like old analog displays. What was one of the features of our old analog video tubes? Yeah. Okay, there you go. Interlaced. Yeah. So between the two of your answers, you're right. So it was technically 50 frames per second because it's interlaced. So it does opposing scan lines, like, you know, half the screen on 25 and half the screen on 25. But that means that the Nintendo hardware actually had to output 50 frames per second. So it was actually putting out 50 frames. So they both get a prize. So 15 frames per second is not going to cut it. We need something a little bit faster. So device tree support actually is a really good solution for this. It's kind of a hack. The way the device tree support works is you upload a device tree file to your boot sector that remaps the GPIO pins. And then when the GPIO pins are remapped, then you can use the pins for display instead of for hooking up hardware components. And you need a daughter board to remap them to a standard LCD header like that. So Adafruit sells a board called the Kippa that does this, which is kind of nice. The only problem with this is you only have 6 GPIO pins left over when you're done. So how many? I mainly use GPIO on these guys for buttons. So how many buttons are on a controller? Who's at 8? Yeah, another prize for that guy. Yes, so there are 8 buttons. So this is bad news. Let's see how bad news it is. So anyone remember the rewards you get for beating a level, a castle level in Mario? Yeah, poo-poo. No princess for you, try again. So my daughter was playing this, and she was very frustrated. When she's used to the newer games, which, like, you collect a little heart, and there's, like, fireworks, and people are cheering, and, like, it's, like, lots of positive reinforcement. This is classic, like, retro gaming. They put you down. They kill you. You get limited lives. You get bad messages when you beat stuff. So it's quite horrible. And that's kind of how I felt when I realized that I didn't actually have enough ports for this. So what I did is I did a little hack using diodes. And can anyone guess now what my hack was?
You don't need all the buttons at the same time.
Yes, very good. So give him something. So basically the left and the right buttons, you can never press them simultaneously. So I hooked up a couple diodes to the start button, so when you press the start button, it simultaneously presses left and right. And same thing for select. When you press select, it simultaneously presses up and down. So this way I'm overloading the left, right, up, down, so I only need dedicated GPIO pins for left, right, up, down, A, B. I don't need a dedicated button for select and start. Now there's a corner case where this doesn't work, which my buddy Andrew, who wrote the emulation library, pointed out, which is you can't. It's not legitimate to press left and right at the same time. But some games, like that boxing game, Mike Tyson's Punch Out, that one requires you to press a directional arrow and like start or select at the same time to execute some of the knockout moves or whatever. So I broke like one game. So it's that's life. But it works pretty well. This is the wiring for the Kippa. This is the button layout for the Kippa. So this this my first controller was actually a breadboard with all these buttons just hardwired in there, which was fun and it was functional. This is how I'd recommend you start it as well. This is the soldering to the board, and soldering multiple wires to a surface mount like this is not easy. I would highly recommend twisted wire instead of solid core wire for this purpose. I mean, in retrospect, it all makes sense. But when you have thick solid wire, it's harder to get the case together. And also, it's too much strength for the solder joints. So if you put too much pressure when you're trying to insert it, the surface mount solder, whatchamacallit, these pads will actually come off. I mean, you need to really be wrenching it to knock a pad off, but I've done it. Also, I would recommend heat shrink wrap around these guys too, because that'll keep the wires isolated nicely. Anyone else want to try the, or did it die? Maybe. Ah, it's off, okay. So this is a semi-completed, yeah? Give him the mic. No, just keep talking. It's fine.
So if you push your breadboard, the white one,
yeah.
And so if there is stress on the cables,
it is easier.
It is really easier than to have this. It's called off. We call this switch.
So a
matrix on this breadboard, even to have a bigger breadboard, whatever, but you should not have more than one connection to a printed board at that point. Or you have a metal pin. If you can put a metal pin in it, then you have a height.
Okay, so you're absolutely right that this is not the right way of doing it if you have a breadboard. But what I was planning to do was I was planning to assemble it so it can fit in here without a breadboard. So when it's assembled, all the breadboard's gone, and these wires are directly connected to the components.
We know that from video recorders from the 1980s. We Germans were proud that we had better video recorders than the US, so our VH2000 was better than VHS. But nowadays, these video recorders were deassembled, and they found exactly that stuff. So the Grundig VH2000s were never, according to now internet resources, they are
the really hard to do, and it comes off. Okay, so this is what it looks like when it's open. My rat's nest looks like when it's open. So stuff soldered on the Kippa. The Kippa is attached to the Raspberry Pi. Then you have a controller you can play, and the Raspberry Pi. Now you're off and you're gaming. And you can do this project at home without a 3D printer, which we'll talk about later. You can just do it with a Raspberry Pi. The touchscreen, which you can buy from Adafruit, or you can pick up one here from a different supplier. And then, you know, your own wiring on the breadboard. And if you don't plan on putting in a case, you can add extra wires to then solder less to the Kippa. Yeah?
I always still wondering why you need an initial daughter
board for only 8 buttons. And if the other one was the same, you need a case station.
Pass on the mic. And I think
Thank you.
Thank you.